Good evening, everyone. I'd like to call this meeting of the Somerset Berkley Regional School Committee to order at 6:17 p.m. Due notice having been posted, let the record show that this meeting is being electronically recorded. And if anyone in the audience also wishes to electronically record this meeting, you should notify the committee at this time. Any such recording may be subject to reasonable restrictions imposed by the chair to the extent permitted under the open meeting law. Roll call, Mrs. Field?
Here.
Mrs. Gagliardi?
Here.
Mr. Ghilarducci?
Here.
Mr. Larabee?
Here.
Mr. Machado?
Here.
Mrs. Terra?
Here.
And the chair is present. Also with us tonight is our superintendent of schools, Jeffrey Schoonover, our director of business and finance, Lindsey Albernaz, our director of special education, Lisa Martiesian, our director of buildings and grounds, Carlos Campos, and our recording secretary, Robin Vaccaro. I'd ask everyone to stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We reorganized our committee on an interim basis because Mr. Ghilarducci had not yet been designated as the Berkley representative. He now has been, so we have a full committee. The next scheduled meeting of the regional school committee will be on Thursday, June 1st, 2017 at 6:30 p.m. at the Somerset Berkley Regional High School School Library. Under new business, I'd like to turn the meeting over to the superintendent at this point to conduct the item appointment of chair and vice chair.
Okay, thank you. As Mr. Peirce just indicated, it is now time to reorganize. Are there any nominations for chair?
I'd like to nominate Mr. Richard Peirce as chair of the regional school committee. Second.
We have a nomination. We have a motion and a second. Are there any other nominations? Discussion.
Well, I think it's. Mr. Peirce has done a fantastic job, and I think continuity is of the utmost importance as we face difficulties in both towns. So I'm hoping that he'll continue to lead us in the right direction.
Any further discussion? Okay, we'll take a vote. All of those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, unanimous.
Congratulations. Thank you. So at this time, I will entertain nominations for vice chair.
I'd like to make a motion to nominate Dean Larabee as vice chair.
Second.
I believe that as we come to speak to what Mrs. Gagliardi said, Mr. Larabee has done a phenomenal job at being a resource for the school committee in the working that they've been doing with Berkley, and I think he would do a phenomenal job keeping that up.
Are there any other nominations? All right. In the absence of further nominations, I'll call for a vote. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Vote for yourself. Oh, I didn't think I could vote for yourself.
Unanimous. Unanimous. We have on the agenda also approval of monthly invoices. Are there any questions on the monthly invoices? That being the case, I think we can hold public input for our joint meeting. So at this point, I think we can remain in open session and leave it to Mr. Machado to call the Somerset Berkley, the Somerset School Committee to order for our joint meeting.
Thank you, Mr. Peirce. I'd like to call the meeting of the Somerset Public Schools School Committee to order at 6:22. due notice have been posted. Let the record show that this meeting is being electronically recorded. And if anyone in the audience also wishes to electronically record this meeting, you should notify the committee at this time. Any such recording may be subject to reasonable restriction imposed by the chair to the extent permitted under the open meeting law. Roll call of members. First of all, is okay, very good. Let the record also show a member of the Somerset School Committee is participating remotely due to a temporary personal
disability.
Mrs. Rothwell is home recovering from a recent surgery and is unable to attend in person. The chair received a request for remote participation from Mrs. Rothwell more than 24 hours in advance of this meeting. As a result, all votes must be taken by roll call. Vice Chair Mrs. Tara?
Here.
Mr. Andrew Crook?
Here.
Mr. Michael Vitello?
Here.
Mrs. Laurie Rothwell?
Here.
And the chair is also here. We've already made a note of who the administration is present, and I'm going to waive the Pledge of Allegiance since we've already done so. The first item on our joint agenda is communication, and at this time I would like to call the committee members of the Music Town for your report and announcement.
Thank you very much. Those of you who might not know me, my name is Donna Murphy. I'm co-chair of the Music Town Festival, along with Jen Lazaro, my mom. And we've gotten our dates together for next year. And unfortunately, there was a controversy last year, which we're trying to put aside and get our dates out early and to everybody, you know, the members of the town. We went to the selectmen's meeting a few weeks ago. So that way, hopefully, we won't get anybody upset with us again. But these are our dates for next year. And we are looking at a Saturday again for the parade for the grand day. Our reason for that is because we have a band show at night, as you know, and feedback from our community said, where are the bands? This is Music Town. What happened to all the bands? And last year we had 8 bands set up to come because they were going to do the parade first, and we were also going to pay for their transportation, which we did. And they were going to do our parade first. Mm-hmm. And then go do the field shows at night. So we're hoping to get the same response this year. We're not doing a Nesba show this year at the request of David Marshall. We're doing a USBA show, which will bring in some bigger bands for us. The biggest show they have in this area is in Connecticut. For that. So we're hoping to get like the bigger bands, Dartmouth, Silver Lake Regional, King Philip. So we're looking at that. And, you know, we are going, last year unfortunately it rained out. So we have nothing to go by again as far as if the Saturday worked, didn't work. But Jen can explain to you a little bit about what's going to happen with the parade. And we're looking forward to providing the community with a great experience, you know, as we have in the past. So this is going to be year 44, which I know my mom and I look at each other and go, what year is this? So we're really excited. We've got a lot of good things happening, and I'll just let Jen tell you about some of them. So thank you for letting us come and talk to you about it. And, you know, we're trying, like I said, get the dates out early so we can also notify businesses and things like that.
I just add that thank you very much. I think this is going to be a great thing to change this because I've heard a lot of feedback, exactly what you said. So I think it's going to be a great turnout.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Your turn.
Thanks, Mrs. Murphy. Mrs. Murphy was my first grade teacher. out there. Thank you very much for allowing us to have an audience with you. As Mrs. Murphy had mentioned, we did want to get the information out sooner rather than later. And to notify the town and the members of the community of the change this year again for the parade to be on a Saturday. The information that we had received, the feedback from previous years and the diminishing of the amounts of marching bands, a lot of school budgets, as we all know, and we're all dealing with those cutbacks. So we're trying to incorporate as much as we can into that one day.
and to make the parade as enjoyable as we can, again, for Somerset, because we are a music town. My dad is a retired music educator in this town, and the Music Town Festival has been in my blood since birth. So I'm very passionate about it, and you know, we kind of wanted to get the ball rolling earlier this year and get your blessing, as well as the selectmen. We've already gotten the proper paperwork out to them to get the permits that were needed to close the side streets. Our next step after talking with you will be to contact the Somerset Police Department and also make sure that that's all taken care of. And then starting early June is notifying all of the businesses that will be affected for about 2 hours for that day, and then kind of get things taken care of sooner rather than later. So, is there any questions? I know last year we were rained out, and unfortunately, it is a logistic nightmare to try and plan two parades. A lot of times people can do one weekend, not another. There's a lot of moving parts to the Music Town Festival and the parade itself. A lot of people involved with their you know, volunteering and the police department and the town themselves. It's really difficult to try and schedule that for two weekends, because basically that's what you'd have to do right from the beginning. It's really unfortunate and unfair, because you know, we really like to you know, represent the music department and all that in our town, because that's what we are. Get us on the map. Music town.
Yes, we are.
That's it. Yep.
Any questions from the committees?
What time is the parade?
So we're looking at a step off right now of around 12:30 in the afternoon. Last year, that time was the same. Seemed to have worked out with some of the businesses that closed at 12. So we'd like to get that step off right at 12:30. We still want to work with the police department too and make sure that that works out as well. So it would be somewhere between 12:30 and 1.
And the U.S. band shows follows that?
In the evening, yes. So basically what it does is it allows those kids that are participating, and it's a full day event for them. They come and they do the parade. We bring them back to the school. We provide them with, you know, lunch and that sort of hanging out and getting to know each other with the different bands, as we used to do back in the day. And then the competitions happen later on at night, around 6 o'clock-ish.
I think he's starting
at
5.
Oh, is he starting at 5 this year?
I think so.
Yeah. So this is a new, like Mrs. Murphy had mentioned, Nesbo was the competition group that we had used previously, and now we're trying out a different one, because this one, as she had mentioned, the U.S. bands is a lot bigger on the music competition scene, and so we wanted to try and bring in some of our closer bands, but also the larger ones.
And the kids will have enough time from ending in the parade to eat, relax.
Oh, absolutely. It's strategically planned so that the first band participating in the competition is also the first band to do the parade, finish up, get back to the school, so that there's plenty of time for rehearsal in between, relaxation, you know.
And did you have Kitty's Day?
Kitty's Day was great last year. It was Star Wars theme.
The uniform was
Frozen.
Great.
Yes.
I think that's gone really well.
This year is going to be a Hawaiian theme for Moana. The kids seem to really appreciate that, especially when you can incorporate something when they're that small.
Right.
We would love to get more of the middle school kids involved. And whether it's to volunteer for the day and help out, or to actually come and see what the high school marching band is all about. So that they have something to look forward to as well. But yeah, the kids, they're absolutely adorable and love that.
We need a vote or anything to approve? Do you need a vote to approve the dates or just a notification? Very good. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you so much, everyone. Have a good night.
Thank you.
Well, thank you for all you do. For the community and for our students. You know, as was mentioned, it's 44 years of Music Town, and Mrs. Aruda is here tonight.
Yes.
And she was there at the beginning, and we certainly appreciate all that she has done over 44 years to make this such a successful event.
The gray showing
up. It's just starting to show now, the gray.
Yeah.
And also, if you can give us Steve St. Howell's best wishes on his retirement, because I know he went down to Florida.
Not yet.
Not
pretty
yet.
Soon.
Well,
yes.
We're very good. But,
we still keep in touch with him.
All right, so the next item we have on the agenda is superintendent's update.
Okay, so I'll keep with this theme. I just wanted to remind the committees that we do have a Memorial Day parade at 10 a.m. The lineup is scheduled at 9:30. I'm not sure which members will be attending. I believe it's been rained out the past 2 years, and right now the weather is a little iffy on Monday. But hopefully we get to have that wonderful parade again, when we both get to see the both the middle school and high school bands, which are just amazing.
For those of us who attended the second grade field trip to Roger Williams Park today, people shouldn't be dissuaded in coming to the parade. This is raining a little.
Yeah. Bring the umbrella.
Let's see. For the really the Somerset committee, just to update you on kindergarten counts, this is the time of year where registration numbers are coming in. We've been conducting kindergarten registrations and screenings. We currently have 55 students at North who are registered, 54 at Chase, and 40 at South. Those numbers do tend to grow a little bit between now and the end of the summer. Some schools a little bit more than others, but it is looking well, last year at this time, Chase had 55 on this day versus the 54 today, and I think we started the school year with 65 or 66. So that number tends to grow by about 10 students. South does not tend to grow that much between now and then, but certainly fewer than 10. And North is a big question mark. Sometimes we've seen 20 students, sometimes we've seen fewer than 10. So that's really the question mark for the number of classes for next year that I'm keeping my eye on, whether North will need three or four. They've been on that bubble each year now for the past 3 or 4 years. Let's see, earlier this week we had Bridgewater State University came to the middle school doing something with seventh graders. They had a 20-foot globe inside the gymnasium. It's called Earthview. There are only two of its kind in the world. It's this massive globe that you can fit an entire class inside, and kids study the geography of the Earth from inside the globe looking out. So the whole thing is hand-painted. It was absolutely amazing. And just thanks to Bridgewater State University and the Center for the Advancement of STEM Education, CASE, that came and provided that day. Sixth graders will have the same opportunity in a few weeks. For those of you who saw Sister Act a couple of weekends ago, I hope you did, because the kids were outstanding. It was, that was one of the best high school performances I've seen. They were just truly amazing the whole time. And for the high school, we do have, this is final exams are starting on Friday for seniors. We have the junior senior prom occurring next Friday, June 2nd. That's at Lake Pearl in Wrentham. The following week is that last week of school. There are lots of events going on between some music awards, athletic award banquets. On June 6th in the evening, which is the Tuesday, there's the National Honor Society Awards. That's when many of the scholarships are given out to seniors that night. That's a great event. And obviously June 9th, Friday, June 9th is graduation. Just if you'd like to inform me or Robin if you are planning on attending, we'll make sure that there are always seats set aside for committee members on the field. I'm not exactly sure what the procession is going to be like this year. I think it might be a little bit different. So just let me know if you're planning on attending, and we'll figure out the logistics later on with you. And I do have, I'll pass this down for the Somerset School Committee members, a thank you note from Emma Giat. Emma was the, if you remember, the eighth grader who came about a month or two ago, and about her anti-bullying presentation. She went and presented this presentation to students at North fifth grade students, third graders at Chase, and she is going to be going to South to do the same thing. In fact, I believe she just did that recently, but she just wrote a thank you note to the school committee for your support. And that wraps up my update for the evening.
I had asked Robin to send me the schedule for graduation week. And so could you send that out to all of the committee members? And I don't know if the K committee members would like to get a copy or not, but we have the, as the superintendent said, we have the National Honor Society night, we have music awards, we have graduation, and then I believe the following week is the sports awards banquet. So,
busy day.
Anyone have any questions for the superintendent? The next item on our agenda is discussion for on future joint meetings. First, publicly, I want to thank the regional meeting. You know, this was a very, I mean, regional committee. It was a real quick meeting that we put together with the help of our chairman, Mr. Peirce. I would like to see a little bit more joint meetings, because it seems like one of the things that I hear from the committee members that serve on both boards, and also sometimes from the administration, it's almost like deja vu. A lot of these items, like today, was on my agenda when we were looking at it for the KDA. We were like, a lot of this has regional items on this, and for them to present this twice, having the music town come in to our meeting twice, I'm kind of asking our K to 8 members to be flexible with your calendars, because when we have a regional meeting, I would like to ask the chairman to invite the K to 8 to it, at least as the beginning portion of the meeting, like they are today. So, because it's easier for the three of us to go, three of our committee members to attend one of their meetings than it is for five of them to attend our meeting. And occasionally we'll have to, you know, be all flexible. So I was just wondering if the committee feels comfortable with that, or if you feel, you know, I know it'd just be a little easier on everyone to have one less meeting, or make our meetings a little shorter than having them respond twice to the same comments.
The only issue I see with that is for those of us in Berkeley who serve in two committees, that will actually increase our meeting schedule, because we'll be coming to joint sessions, individual sessions, and K-8 sessions as well in Berkeley, because Cris and I both currently serve in joint capacity. So I don't mind meetings, I go to tons of them, but.
Can we ask the chair and the vice chair to, and work with the administration, to, how often, how much material do you see is overlapping? Is it on a monthly basis? Is it every other month? Is it heavy at the beginning and the end of the years? In your sense, going through this, how much of the material is overlap?
It's, as you can see from tonight's agenda, I think that toward the end of the year, there tend to be a little bit more more things in common between the two, just for contracts and so on, whether it's with vendors or employees for the following year. There are certain times where it's a little bit heavier, and then we may have several months in a row where there are very few things in common. So we can try to put together a schedule, and we can look back at both agendas for the past year and identify where the overlap tends to exist.
Yeah, I'd be willing to do joint meetings, but I would want it dictated by the agenda. So I would leave it up to the chairs to decide, instead of just making a blanket statement that we'll do joint meetings, because I think that just might add.
I don't think we should just have a joint meeting, Right. It would always be dictated by the agenda items. Okay. Like today, looking at today's agenda, I saw like there's seven items that just didn't make sense to have them presented twice.
Got it.
Now, when we did our schedule for this current year, we scheduled some joint meetings in consultation with the KA committee. So we can certainly look at that as we both come up with our schedules for the next year, and the next, probably in the next month, we can look at. designating certain meetings, and then if there isn't anything on that we really need to talk about jointly, then we can always just move it.
Can I say I envision this, that it would not be more meetings, it would be less meetings, or the meetings would be shorter? Because this is not a new idea, we've been trying to do this for a while now. I just would like it to seem more consistent, and I know the administration will be able to plan that. So there's some things that could wait until a joint meeting and then just get to the business that we need to do separately for all committees. So I'm looking forward to it. I think it definitely will put less pressure on the administration. So for this to work out.
Good. So the next item we have.
Lori?
Yes, if I could jump in, just that, you know, I'm in total agreement that if we can work on having joint meetings that will, address those items that do overlap. I know in the past that we did attempt to come up with a year-long agenda where we had place marked certain items that we knew needed to be addressed. It might be a suggestion that we look at the next year and identify when transportation contracts need to be addressed, or food service, or various things that we could identify. Well, maybe this is a good time to schedule a joint meeting, and then possibly have an update with our curriculum director or our technology director. Those were things that we had attempted to do in the past. So I know it's always a work in progress. So I applaud the chairs to try to continue to reduce the amount of meetings.
Thank you, Lori. Anyone else? So the next item we have on the agenda is food service agreement. There are two separate agreements, but they're pretty much identical. Well, there are some slight differences. So is there a presentation on this?
I'm just going to speak about it, and then our food service director, Jason Renzi, can take more specific questions if you want them. So if you want to start with, we have to have two separate agreements, two separate districts. Currently, we're in year two of our three-year contract with Chartwell's. What this extension agreement is asking to do is follow through with them for the third year. We will have to go out to bid next year, probably around the March, beginning of April timeframe. But I don't think I'm alone when I say that I think Chartwell's has done wonders for our food service program for both districts. It's gone, and a lot of that has everything to do with Jason and the Chartwell's vision. I think they're a great company, and I think that they've done good things for our students and our faculty. So I would really enjoy being able to work with them for not only next year, but for future years, depending on how the bid process goes. So the Somerset Public Schools agreement number, they are kind of identical. So you have to look at the top line, to the Olay and Beverage District. This would allow us to extend into FY18, so for next school year, for one more year. Some of the highlights include section 3, 4, and 5, which is essentially the administrative fee that they charge us just because, Chartwell's is the organization that's running the program, a management fee, which is a flat fee that we do pay as part of our invoices every single month. So those two numbers, and it's the same for the high school as well, if you want to look at them concurrently. Last year, or this school year, the amount was $1,539. Next year would be $1,576. It's a 2.4% increase for both of those fees. Section 5 is where I really get, kind of interested. It talks about the break-even or the guaranteed return. So for Somerset Public Schools, Chartwell's is saying that for the 2017-18 school year, we will see no less than a profit of $67,938. This year we're trending approximately at $65,000, which is where our guaranteed return dictated last year at this time in this contract. So it is trending accurately. So nothing really different as far as a guaranteed return from their perspective. I think $65,000 is a wonderful balance to have in your food service program at the end of the year if you can do it. So that is
Somerset Public highlights, Somerset Berkley, the guaranteed break-even would be zero at this point. Last year, that contract had, I believe, a $12,000 deficit in the contract. So break-even is a positive. I did push the district manager for why is it only break-even, and we're just at the point where break-even is better than a deficit, and so we want to break even at a minimum. So I think we're heading in the right step for the high school. I think next year's contract, you would actually see a guaranteed return in this number. So that's really the highlight for the high school. The high school's school lunch program is actually trending in about a $15,000 profit this year. So it's better than we expected. So it's going well.
Lindsey, has that contributed to any of the services that we're doing now for the extended menu at breakfast, as well as any of the snack service that we're doing after school?
The snack services, I'll let Jason talk, because he's okay. The one that actually does the work.
So can I just, before you do that,
sure.
What's the significance of the change in number two from 3 to 6? We don't have that provision of the contract. I didn't dig it out, but that number is changing from 3 to 6. What's the significance there?
I'd have to look it up. If you can give me a few minutes while Jason speaks, I can have an answer for you.
Okay.
So the after-school program at the high school, we ran it for a month. It cost us about $600-$700 in labor to run that program. We made a total of about $119 in sales. So at the end of that month, I thought it was beneficial for us to cut the program because we were open for 2.5 to 3 hours every day after, and the labor cost to run it without the business just wasn't beneficial for us. Some schools that we have in other districts have great after-school programs, some schools just don't. We gave it a good shot. We had hot meals, we had cold meals, we had sports drinks, we had flavored waters. We even did pretzels, whole grain pretzels that were warm, sold slices of pizza, talked to the band, had their instructor know that we were down there. He'd actually come down, but he didn't bring many kids with him, unfortunately. So we did give it that an effort. I was there every day with them running it, because it would take two people, so I was the one that ran it by myself for a couple days, and then I brought in someone else just to help me cook the pizzas and have warm stuff. And we were making, fresh sandwiches, so we had everything there for them. Unfortunately, it just didn't pan out the way we wanted to. I think if the students were able to take the food outside of the cafe, it would be a different story. I think a lot of them, the kids that did come, they mm-hmm. felt, they did have the stuff that they're like, well, I gotta go back to band, or I gotta go back to there, the few kids that came, and I'm like, unfortunately, I have to eat it in here, or go outside and eat on the patio. And the best days for us were when it was raining, because the teams would practice inside, so we had the softball team in there one day, and we had some other students in there that were just waiting to use a classroom and stuff like that. So. But unfortunately, I wish it worked. I think it's a great program. We tried it. Like I said, I was there every day with it. And if it could just break even, I would do it every day. It just, didn't work out.
How was it marketed?
My grandson misses it greatly.
Yep, there was certain students that were there with us every day.
Yeah.
But, $119 at the end, because we tried to get the most value out of everything. It wasn't try to make the best profit margin. It was try to have a student come down, get a complete meal, get a vegetable, a fruit, and a water included with their sandwich. So we tried to make it work. We pushed it, we marketed it through every morning. It was announced.
Mm-hmm.
And at the end of the day, it was announced. I also had flyers up all around where we're permitted. So we did have it out there. We marketed it before it was even open, a couple days before, just so the kids could know. We had students walk right through to go to the buses, so it was known. It just, for some reason, it just didn't kick off as I thought it would.
Can I ask a question? They can't leave the cafeteria with that, but...
Water they can.
Just the water, but bands and other sports and clubs, when they're in other rooms, they, when they practice a long time or they do things, I'm pretty sure they can eat food that they bring.
Absolutely not.
Not supposed to.
Not at the high school.
Okay.
I just know we were.
If they do, they do it on the down low, but they are not allowed.
So they're supposed to be there after school till 5, 6, 7 o'clock and not eat, pretty much. That's a building.
They can eat in the dining center.
Yeah.
So there's always open even if they're not here.
It's accessible.
I just know when we started the program, we were especially told that students, unless it's water, so that's why I tried to bring in the flavor. We have the flavored waters there just as much so they could take them with them. But we were responsible for letting the students know, hey, just stay in the caf, eat here. If it was a nice day out, they could eat on the patio. We had trash bins out there for them and everything. So.
Do you think the timing, because you did that kind of in the second part of the year, have you noticed in other districts where you've implemented those programs that sometimes starting like at the start of the year where you have a whole new class that's used, you know, that's what they've known has always been there, has that had any impact?
I can't speak to other districts. I just know some districts, they take off with it.
Yeah.
They have a little more flexibility in their buildings, because the building's a little older. The teachers would, or the after-school counselors, whoever's involved, order a whole pizza for them and be like, you know, bring it to the classroom, we're gonna do this, bring it up and do that. And they'd have pizza parties and stuff like that. I did talk to Mr. Lanzinski in the beginning of the year about it, and he, when we did start it, he said that would be a good time because we had a lot of students with track, with everybody in the building. So I felt like we had a really good sample size. I felt like we did a really good job with the presentations, with the salads, the sandwiches, made to order stuff. We had hot meals at certain points. You know, we tried to just make smells go. You know, if I had a fan, I would have blown it down the hallway. But, you know, like I said, the warm pretzels, you could smell them when we were making them. They were fresh, warm pretzels, so you could smell them. Couldn't put the salt on them, but you know, it is what it is, and you know, with the nutrition guidelines.
Did you say the $119 in sales?
Yeah.
Was there a pickup towards the end of the sample period, or not really?
Well, a couple of days was just me getting a soda water. I bought a couple, and then towards the end, it was more in the middle. We had, like, when there was no softball practice or baseball practice, they'd come in and kind of get, you know, I think the best day we had was like a $32 day.
Okay.
And that was, like I said, it was raining out and we had the students inside the cab.
So there was no momentum?
No, it was so choppy where some days we didn't see one person some days.
Well, thank goodness you bought soda water those days.
Yeah, I did. I got the canned soda water for $1. So, you know, I was trying to keep it going and try to see people. Well, I feel like a lot of people do things with their eyes. So if they're walking through and they see me with a soda water or a sandwich or something, that they'd be like, oh, we can get food. You know, sometimes, you know, they don't listen at the end of the day or before the day because they're just in their own head.
So could you tell us about the breakfast program? How's that going at the high school?
The breakfast program, we have not started with the grant yet. We have ordered the blenders, the cart, but those take a little while to ship them in. So as soon as we get the invoice and the date of delivery, we can start the smoothies and all that. Breakfast program right now is holding its own. It's very steady. You know, we do anywhere between 35 and 40 breakfasts a day right now. We broke the record, like I said, in the last school meeting where we did have a day we did 50 breakfasts, and that is something we've never done since I've been here. So breakfasts are solid, but once we get the new, use the grant funds for the new cart, the new smoothie machines, and we use those funds to have a kickoff, which I think we're gonna do right at the beginning of the year. Next year, we'll have some balloons out there. We'll have a couple banners out there. We'll have a nice kickoff because the Dairy Council wants to be involved in it. They've been asking me when we're going to plan it so they can come and kind of have the kickoff and stuff like that. So I think the smoothies will be a great thing with the machine on the cart and just the students hearing the commotion of the machine going on, making them and seeing us pour them. I think they'll, you know, think it's like a juice bar and stuff like that. So I think it'll be something where it's an action station and they'll hear it, they'll see it, and they'll taste it right there. So,
I have a question for the superintendent. Mrs. Glover, do you know the time frame? Are the kids getting a break from the time school ends, the time they start a sport or music? I just want to ensure that. I think part of the program when this was talked about was because kids were like going to Subway and other places, and why not make it more convenient? But now I'm kind of wondering, are kids getting that break? or are they just expected to keep going right until 6-7 o'clock without eating?
It
I mean, they can go in the cafeteria, but obviously they're not.
It depends on what's happening after school. So if there's a game, most games, I believe, would begin at 3:30 or so. Mm-hmm. School's out at 2:05, so there is, kids do have downtime in between school getting out and when practices or sports competitions begin. Some days it might be a little bit tighter than others, but there is some time in there. For groups like band and show choir, they are not starting immediately after school, so there is time between when they get out at 2 o'clock roughly and when those are starting. Sometimes the I would say on average it's about 45 minutes or so.
I saw kids had a break before and they were allowed to eat, so now with the new high school I'm just not sure of that. Like, are the kids being able to be well hydrated and, you know, take care of the needs so they can perform their best? So
kids are not rushing from class and then sprinting to practice.
And just to jump in real quick, Vic, my mindset, we're not totally shutting off the door. If we see something or a trend and we hear stuff, and we can always revisit it again, try something new. I always like suggestions, I always like open minds, so if we see something happen, we hear something, that door's never shut. I know my staff is always looking for new stuff, and they do a great job with, you know, coming up with ideas, so we're very fortunate we have a great staff at the high school and a great staff at the public schools that I'm lucky enough to work with that listen, that want to do better and always want to grow the product and help the students. So by any means at the high school, that program is never shut. Like, we'll try it, we'll try different things, we'll talk to more students, we'll have more focus groups and try to feel what we need to do to fit into their lives, because that's what we're hospitality, so that's what we do. We try to fit into their busy schedule, and so there's nothing closed. We want to try to get the program going, and if we have to change a little bit and cater to them, we're all ears.
Mrs. Rothwell?
Yeah, Jason, I just wanted to jump in to first of all say thank you for all the work, and I appreciate the creativity you have exhibited in the past year, or the years, to try to boost our program. And if I heard you correctly, I did understand that we are not in a deficit in any of the schools. We are at least breaking even, is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. Now, I understand that there was an issue at, and I know specifically the middle school, and I believe at the elementary school, where there were certain students that did have a deficit in their school lunch accounts, and we did give alternative meals to them.
Yep. So we did start off with students that had anything more than negative $10 on their account, that they would get a substitute meal of a cheese sandwich, a fruit, a vegetable, and their choice of a water or milk. We did that for a week, and then we decided to pull that back, and we had some suggestions that we heard, and went up to $30. So that's two full weeks of meals that a student can charge to their account, where they can still choose one out of the three options. Now after that $30, they get two options. So they get, now they can choose from a cheese sandwich or a sun butter and jelly sandwich with fruit, vegetable, milk, or water. So that's what we're currently at right now.
And has there been any brainstorming to try to figure out how we can alleviate for a student to go through the hot meal line, and then have, if they have a negative balance that's over the $35, that they wouldn't have a hot meal taken away, be given one of these alternative meals? Because to me it doesn't seem like it's makes sense, and I know that we had a discussion with the committee that we didn't want to, obviously not provide a meal. We're going to provide a meal, but if we're throwing away a hot meal to give an alternative meal, it seems like we're spending money on that hot meal that we have to discard.
Yeah. So
I was just wondering if there is any way that we could identify the students or before they go through the hot meal line, so we don't have to have this issue.
Yep, so we never want to target a specific student and pull them out of line and bring it out. So what we did, like I said, we took some suggestions, and now we don't do the white bag like we first started to. So now students know when they get there, they grab it just like any other student now. So we'll have them politely get out of line, and they'll go back and grab a tray just like everybody else. There's no white bag, lunch bag where we have at the register anymore. Students can go grab their choice, grab what they want, put it on the tray, and then go through the line. After the first day, or if they're at it, the students do know. When we first do it, it's no more than four or five students right now that we actually have that substitute meal for. The first week with $10, I think our high number was 11. So it's not a big number where we're grabbing stuff. And we never throw food in the trash in front of a student. You know, we never discuss their financials in front of our students. We simply just show them the screen and say, just please let your parents know. And we give them a little reminder card as well. So they have a little more to put in their pocket so they can just show their parents. That has my contact information on it. So if they have any questions, I can send them their transactions receipt as well, so they can see where they're at.
Ms. Rothwell, it's Melissa. I believe we made a policy on this that parents would be notified, and that was the whole point. And we even discussed, I remember when I was on the board, if their parents that are just not feeding their kids, I mean, there is actions we can take as administrators if that's the case. So I mean, I definitely was against shaming any kids, and there's steps to go as far as kids getting meals and parents not adhering to paying the bill. We discussed this in length a couple of years ago, that it was about going after the parents and not the children.
Right, and you're absolutely correct, and that's really where I'm driving in my concern. We may have to come to a point where we have to revisit the policy, because the policy as it's written today states that it's less than the $35 that we've adopted now, before we would give an alternative meal. So that is something that if we're working through the process, and we now have most of those accounts that are now in a positive balance, then that's great. I know that we're always going to have some that are in the negative, but we may have to put this on the agenda to discuss the policy to make sure that the policy matches the practice.
So can I just ask one more question about the high school program? What are the issues there that put us at a break even? Obviously, we're not like looking to make a big profit in the lunch program at the high school, but the fact is that while the contract says that we're guaranteed to break even, well, it doesn't actually say we're guaranteed to break even. It says that if we don't break even, you'll forfeit your $7,800 fee, but anything beyond that, we eat. So if we had a $20,000 deficit in the school lunch program at the high school, we'd be out $12,000. So we'd like to have a little more of a cushion than break even. So what are the issues there? Is it a need to increase participation? Is it the federal guidelines that make the food less appealing to the students? What do you see as the issues that keep us from, you know, having a little more of a cushion in our school lunch program? And you've got a $67,000 cushion at the K-8 district. Is it just that those kids are hungrier? or, I mean, I've also heard that sometimes the older kids prefer to skip lunch and go out after school and spend whatever money they'd spend on a school lunch at one of the local pizza shops, because they think they get they don't have to order a whole grain pizza, and I don't know. So what do you see as the issues that are kind of holding the high school program?
Well, the contract, unfortunately, my DM, Erin Long, was gonna be here to contribute, but she got stuck in some traffic. She can speak to that a lot more specifically than I can. I just go on the budgeting line, I look at what budgeting, and I feel very confident that if we are to come back, the contract would look a little different than the break even. I think we've grown every year at the high school. When we first started, my first year here, we were guaranteed a loss, and we came above that number. And this year, My gut and my the statistics that I'm looking at tell me that we're going to come a little better than last year. Our participation has grown. Our menus have gotten a lot more, have gotten creative, and we are adapting to the student a lot more. Of course, we have the federal guidelines we have to follow. Sometimes students don't like it. Sometimes students don't really mind it. You know, unfortunately, whole grain is a part of it, and we have to do a better job, which we have. Like I said, I'm very fortunate where I have the ladies and the workers there to put the time, put the effort, and want to make that whole grain pasta look better than, quite frankly, a lot of other districts around. I think we put out a top shelf product. I'm very confident that we're going to make money for years to come. We're always going to make money. The days of a deficit are over, in my opinion. And as long as I'm here, I know I'm going to try not to have a deficit. So, I know the contract stays out. Like I said, I can't really get into the specifics of the contract because she knows more of the legal of that contract.
Yeah, I wasn't trying to renegotiate the contract.
Yeah,
I just wondered if you saw some areas where we might improve.
Yeah, so I think I had a conversation with Lindsey this past week where, you know, every year I try to grow on the menu. First year was our first year here. I didn't know, when I was coming in, I didn't know the skills, the knife skills, the sanitation skills. I didn't know what these ladies knew. I'm confident now that next year we're gonna have a lot more action stations. So you're gonna start seeing a lot more where we'll have a guest chef come in. Might be me, the guest chef, but we'll have someone in there. We'll have a lot more people action cooking. This year we had a great noodle bar where we were making the noodles right in front of the students, and we put them in like nice little takeout containers, and they had chopsticks to have with. You know, the sky's the limit. We're gonna have a lot more action. We're gonna have a lot more fresh ingredients, a lot more cutting on the board. So you'll see julienne, you'll see julienne vegetables, I don't know. But you'll see that kind of stuff. You know, like even at the public schools, we're making all our own burgers here. We don't buy a pre-made burger anymore. All our burgers are made by the ladies, by their hands, and we have them made in-house. So we're slowly getting there. Next year, it's gonna be a little more challenging for the ladies, but you know, said they're the best. They really push the envelope. Anytime I put something in front of them, they may give me a funny look, but once we get it done, they're like, it's actually pretty good. So I'm confident the high school, you won't ever have to worry about that negative balance where you're on the hook for $12,000 again, so.
So just one other question regarding the management fees and the administrative fees. Have those changed from previous years? Is there an increase there, and what is it?
2.4%.
Both of them?
Mm-hmm. So the answer to your question, Rick, about the 3 and 6, which is section 9.1, that's basically record retention for claim reports, commodity ordering that we do. We are required to keep it for 6 years, not 3.
Okay. Any other questions from the regional committee? K8 committee?
Thank you, Jason.
With no further questions, I'd like to entertain a motion that we accept the amendment contract for Chartwell's for one more year.
Second.
All right. Okay, we have a motion made by Mrs. Terra and seconded by Mr. Botello. We're going to go with a roll call. Mrs. Rothwell?
Aye.
Mr. Botello?
Aye.
Mr. Crook?
Aye.
Mrs. Terra?
Aye.
And the chair votes aye as well.
I will entertain a motion to approve amendment number 4 to the Chartwell's contract for the next year as provided to us.
So moved. Second.
Motion made by Mrs. Gagliardi and seconded by Mrs. Field. Any further discussion? Absent further discussion, all those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Thank you.
Our next item is the school lunch prices for fiscal year 2018. Mrs. Albernaz.
So you have in your hands a double-sided document. One is this landscape grid. The other side of it, I just want you to kind of just put a big X through the back of that because for some reason the wrong attachment got sent. So you have a revised one coming down currently. with the correct numbers. I'm not sure what exactly happened, but I must have sent the wrong one to Robin, but I apologize. So every year, under the USDA, we are required to analyze our school lunch prices and determine whether or not they must be increased so that we're not supplementing our food service program by government reimbursements using the free and reduced student population. So what basically what that means is we can't be charging students less. So basically what that means is we can't be charging a student less than what we actually get back from the government for a free or reduced school lunch price. So historically we have looked at our prices. We have to use this price adjustment calculator every year. We do, this document is just the elementary and middle school only. So basically the grid that you see brings our weighted average price using this year's school lunch prices to $2.78. The weighted average price that is required for school year 2017-18 is $2.86. So what that means is we have an 8-cent gap in our school lunch prices. So essentially, we could be putting our reimbursements at risk if we do not adjust the school lunch price. This is something that we have to do. We do not have a choice unless we want to lose a lot of money in reimbursements that we get from our claims processing for those students. So what we want to do is look at some potential options of doing a school lunch increase. And the way that we've done it historically is if the middle school goes up, the high school follows that price, because what we didn't want to see was elementary pays one price, middle school pays another, and then the high school ends up paying less than what the middle school was paying. So what we've been doing was trying to at least match those numbers, and I think that that's been going pretty well. So it does kind of tie into the high school, but the high school is not required to have the price adjustment calculator because we don't need it for that school. So that's more of a conversation for K-8. So on the back, which is your grid, you can see the four different scenarios that we have here. The scenario one would be a 15-cent increase from 270 to 285 for the elementary, and from 290 to $3 for the middle school. Scenario two would be 15-cent increase for elementary, and no increase for middle school. Scenario three is a 10-cent increase for elementary, 5-cent increase for middle school. And then scenario four is 10 cents for both schools. So what Chartwells and Jason and I recommend is scenario four. So we would get to that $2.86 with a little bit of cushion. So next year we could potentially not have to increase prices at all. It would carry, the credit would carry forward to next year, and potentially we might not have to increase them at all, which is, I know that we're in year three of increasing lunch prices, but which we don't want to do, but if we're mandated and I don't want to lose thousands of dollars in reimbursements, then we potentially might not have to increase prices next year. But I recommend scenario four, which would bring elementary school lunch prices from 270 to 280 and middle school from 290 to $3.
And so you're recommending that the high school lunch price be $3?
Mm-hmm.
That makes a lot of sense to me. So you don't have to give a kid 15, or a student 15 cents back.
You had a lot of change.
Although I assume most students have an account where they just punch in rather than paying cash.
Yep. We have primarily cash sales. It's
really
what bring, yeah, more than, they use a lot of cash. So we do have a lot of change.
Okay. You repeat those prices again?
For the recommended?
Yeah.
So it would be $2, going from 270 to 280 for elementary,
and $290 to $3 for the middle school.
And the high school.
And the high school would match the middle school.
That works.
Does anybody have any questions? The only thing I have an issue with is we have like a surplus of $67,000 or something like that right now, and we're about to charge parents more money for the lunch, and I understand we're being mandated by the government and all of that. It's just, last time I kind of mentioned that, you know, it seems like we're doing this every year, and again, we're doing it, and next year, you know, we're gonna try not to, but I think we will end up doing it, because so far I haven't seen any, I haven't seen a trend that we're not doing it every single, but the thing is, we have a profit. That's, you know, it almost seems like the lunch program, in my opinion, wasn't to be making money on families, but because of the free and reduced lunch, we're being forced to do so, but, so. Because there are four options, does someone want to make a motion on the recommended motion, or you want me to entertain one?
I'll make a motion to go with the pricing for scenario four, because elementary would be $280 and middle school would be $3.
I'll second that.
Okay, we have a motion on the floor made by Mr. Patel, seconded by Mr. Crook. To go with option four as presented. By roll call, Mrs. Rothwell?
Aye.
Mr. Patello?
Aye.
Mr. Crook?
Aye.
Mrs. Tara?
Aye.
And the chair also votes aye.
I will entertain a motion to increase the price of the school lunch to $3.
So moved.
Second. Motion made by Mrs. Gagliardi, seconded by Mr. Larabee. Is there any further discussion? Yes, further discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous.
I do want to add that we did ask the state to allow us to roll in the high school's monthly sales number to see if we can reduce that average price, but they would not allow us to do that. So it was worth a shot.
So the next item we have on the agenda is boiler, electrical, and heating, ventilation, and air conditioning contracts. Mrs. Albernaz.
So we went up to bid in May of last year, well, we awarded results in May of last year for our plumbing, our electrical repairs, and our boiler burner services. What the contract states is that it's a three-year contract with options of renewing year two and three. So what I'm asking here in the memos is to allow me to enter into a second renewal with each of these three vendors. The contract does indicate a cost per living. It's really a CPI inflation, which is 1.8%. So the hourly rate and the overtime rates listed for each of these three would include those new rates. So I'm just asking both school committees to allow me to enter into one-year extensions with each of these vendors for these services.
Lindsey, is there a rationale behind just a one-year extension? Is that something that we're required to do by 1 year, or is it beneficial? Is there any benefit to the region and the districts if we did something longer? I'm just curious, not to hold up the process. I know, I'm just curious from a...
No, the 3 year, it's for a 3 year contract, but you have to renew every year. So you're asking if we can do like a 5 year?
No, I'm just, that clarifies.
You still have to renew every year.
Yeah. Yeah.
Somewhat charged with service.
Can I ask, are these rates, because we have to pay prevailing wage for this type of work?
Mm-hmm.
Because, and do, when we get these bids, do we get any breakdown, or all they required to do is provide an hourly rate, or are they required to provide an hourly rate and then a labor burden and I'm troubled by some of these prices. I understand we went out to bid, but $110 an hour. Does the $110 an hour include the 20% markup, or do we pay a 20% markup in addition to $110 an hour?
The markup is for parts that we have to order.
Pardon me?
It's only for parts that we would have to order.
I see. So we'll be going out to bid next year. Do we know by any chance whether these rates are comparable to what neighboring school districts are paying for these this kind of service?
I do not know that.
I also don't believe we are going out to bid. This is year two, correct?
Mm-hmm.
So we still have one more year. Okay. Any questions from the K committee? With no more questions, I'd like to entertain a motion that we extend to year two with for our plumbing work with the DDS Industries of Fall River.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion by Mr. Botello and seconded by Mrs. Rothwell. By roll call, Mrs. Rothwell?
Aye.
Mr. Botello?
Aye.
Mr. Crook?
Aye.
Mrs. Tara?
Aye.
And the chair votes aye.
Do you want me to do these one?
I want to do them all, if you want to.
Well, we can be into which one would you do?
I just did the plumbing work.
Okay. Well, I'll entertain a motion to approve the bid from plumbing work to provide plumbing services for the next year.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mrs. Field and seconded by Mr. Machado. Any further discussion? The absence of discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous.
I'd like to entertain a motion for year two on the electrical repairs to Watermark Electric Company.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion made by Mrs. Tara, seconded by Mr. Crook. By roll call, Mrs. Rothwell?
Aye.
Mr. Botello?
Aye.
Mr. Crook?
Aye.
Mrs. Tara?
Aye.
And the chair votes aye.
I'll entertain a motion to approve the bid for Watermark Electric Company to provide electrical repair services for the next year.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Machado and seconded by Mr. Larabee. Any discussion? The absence of discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous.
I'd like to entertain a motion for year two to advance air of East Freetown for our boiler and burner repairs.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion made by Mrs. Tara, seconded by Mr. Patel. By roll call, Mr. Did I read the wrong one?
No.
Okay.
I just didn't.
sorry about that. Mrs. Rothwell?
Aye.
Mr. Patel?
Aye.
Mr. Crook?
Aye.
Mrs. Tara?
Aye.
And the chair also votes aye.
I'll entertain a motion to approve the bid received from Advanced Air and Heat Company to provide boiler and burner repairs and maintenance work for the next year.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mrs. Gagliardi and seconded by Mr. Machado. Any discussion? The absence of discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous.
And the next item is for our gas supplier contract. Mrs. Albernaz.
So what you have in front of you is a potential contract renewal for our gas supply service. We have a 3-year contract with Sprague Operating Resources to purchase our gas needs for both districts. Currently, we are locked in at a rate of $5.65 per MMBTU. And what Sprague Operating Resources is offering us starting in August of 2018, when our current contract expires, is to offer us a price of $5.47, which is 18 cents cheaper than what we're paying now. So I would love to take advantage of that for a 3-year period. And the savings for that would be about $3,200 per year for K-8 and
and $1,000 per year for the region. But obviously, it's a three-year contract, so I need to get the school committee's approval. This is not anything related to Liberty Utilities, which is in charge of distribution, delivery. This is basically just what we pay for the supply.
Are there any comments or questions?
Lindsey, what's the rationale for the decrease in costs? Is it just the supply?
Good time to lock it in the market, yeah.
And it won't change over the duration of the
year? No, it has to stay at this price. It's fixed.
Is it part of a like how big is the group that's buying to just the two school districts or other multiple districts that negotiate that rate for that electrical?
We used to be part of a consortium for our gas and electric, and when I came on, we had discussions, and then I did some of my own research, and I actually ended up finding that we got a better rate going out on our own and doing it this way. So I'm not sure what, if you were part of a consortium, what it would cost now, but I don't know if you, they would get $5.27, so.
But obviously, any decreases, a good
one. Right.
I wasn't sure if we're part of that consortium or not, because I.
Not anymore.
Okay.
No further questions. I'd like to entertain a motion for a three-year contract for our national gas. And we wanted to Sprague Operating Resources, LLC.
So moved.
We have a motion. We have a motion made by Mr. Battello, seconded by Mrs. Tara. By roll call, Mrs. Rothwell?
Aye.
Mr. Battello?
Aye.
Mr. Crook?
Aye.
Mrs. Tara?
Aye.
And the chair also votes aye.
I will entertain a motion to approve the Sprague Operating Resources agreement we have before us.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mrs. Gagliardi, seconded by Mr. Ghilarducci. Any further discussion? In the absence of discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous.
Thank you. Good job, Lindsey.
Yeah, thanks, Lindsey.
Thank you.
Next item on the agenda is, under new business, is to consider changing the 2017-2018 school calendar. Mr. Schoonover?
As a result of the annual town meeting in Somerset a few weeks ago, what was it, last week, the meeting for the annual town meeting has changed.
The town election.
What was it?
Second week in April.
So it's the town election that's taking place that day, which is the day that we need the student dining center at the high school to be utilized. So as a result, we need to change the early release day from May until April 9th. So you'll see April 2018, April 9th is now shaded in purple as an early release day. And that would affect both school districts.
Does anyone have any questions? With that, I'll entertain a motion that we consider the change for the 2017 and 2018 school calendar, as noted by the superintendent.
So moved.
We have a motion made by Mrs. Tara, seconded by Mr. Crook. By roll call, Mrs. Rothwell?
Aye.
Mr. Patello?
Aye.
Mr. Crook?
Aye.
Mrs. Rothwell? Mrs. Tara?
Aye.
And the chair also votes aye.
I will entertain a motion to approve the change in the 2017-2018 school calendar recommended by the superintendent.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mrs. Gagliardi and seconded by Mr. Larabee. Any further discussion? In the absence of discussion, all those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous.
And now we're under unfinished business. The first topic is our superintendent's contract.
Who are the negotiators? Myself and Mr.
Jury.
Okay. But I think we considered this in executive session, and then again, I believe, an open session. and we just deferred action on this contract until the regional school committee had actually been finalized, and Mr. Ghilarducci had joined us, so I think everyone's had an opportunity to see this contract, and we've discussed it a couple of times already, so we're at a position where we can approve it in open session. So I will entertain a motion to approve the renewal of the superintendent's contract in the form that has been provided to each of us.
So moved. Second.
Motion made by Mrs. Gagliardi and seconded by Mrs. Field. Is there any further discussion? In the absence of discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous.
I'll entertain a motion that we support the new contract for the superintendent, Jeffrey Schoonover, as presented.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion made by Mrs. Tara, second by Mr. Crook. Any questions? By roll call, Mrs. Rothwell?
Aye.
Mr. Botello?
Aye.
Mr. Crook?
Aye.
Mrs. Tara?
Aye.
And the chair also votes aye. Congratulations, Jeff.
Thank you.
So the next item that we have on the agenda is to consider acceptance of joint open session minutes of May 15th, 2017.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Motion made by Mr. Machado and seconded by Mrs. Field. Any discussion? In the absence of discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
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 Any opposed?
I abstain.
I abstain.
Okay. I have an abstention.
I want to forget.
We have an abstention for Mr. Ghilarducci, Mrs. Gagliardi, and
we vote on these separately, right?
Yeah, correct.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. So
I'd like to.
So let me just. So we have Mr. Larabee, Mrs. Field, and myself. Mr. Botello. Okay. So all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Opposed? All right. So we have five votes in the affirmative and two abstentions. Mrs. Rothwell also abstains. Okay.
I'd like to make a motion that we consider the acceptance of the joint open session minutes of May 15th.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion made by Mrs. Tara, seconded by Mr. Botello. By roll call, Mrs. Rothwell, you're abstaining, correct?
That is correct.
Mr. Botello?
Aye.
Mr. Crook?
Aye.
Mrs. Tara?
Aye.
And the chair also votes aye.
I will entertain a motion to accept the joint executive session minutes of May 15th, 2017.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Machado and seconded by Mrs. Field. Any discussion? In the absence of discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
Okay, so we have five votes in the affirmative and two abstentions. Abstentions by Mr. Ghilarducci and Mrs. Gagliardi.
And I'll also entertain a motion to acceptance of the joint executive session minutes of May 15, 2017.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion made by Mrs. Tara, seconded by Mr. Crook. By roll call, Mrs. Rothwell.
Abstention as well, again.
Mr. Botello?
Aye.
Mr. Crook?
Aye.
Mrs. Tara? And the chair also votes aye.
So should we ask for public input at this point?
Oh, yeah.
We don't have it on the agenda, but
no,
we did have.
Oh, yes.
Okay. So are there any matters of public input during the course of our joint meeting? So at this point, I will entertain a motion pursuant to Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 38, Section 21A3, to conduct strategy with respect to collective bargaining with the American Federation of State, County, and Municipal Employees, AFSCME units clerical and custodial, and with the Somerset Teachers Association, STA units A and B, because discussion in open session may have a detrimental effect on the committee's bargaining position, and the chair so declares. And also pursuant to Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 38, Section 21A2, to conduct contract negotiations with non-union personnel, specifically the Director of Business and Finance, Lindsey Albernaz. So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Machado and seconded by Mrs. Field. A roll call. Mrs. Terra?
Aye.
Mr. Machado?
Aye.
Mrs. Field?
Aye.
Mrs. Gagliardi?
Aye.
Mr. Ghilarducci?
Aye.
Mr. Larabee?
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. The Regional School Committee will not return to open session at the conclusion of the executive session.
I'll make the same motion. Pursuant to Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 30A, Section 21A3, to conduct strategy. Why can I never say that word? Thank you. With respect to collective bargaining with American Federation of State, County, Municipal Employees, AFSCME units, clerical and custodial, and with the Somerset Teachers Association units A and B, because discussion in open session will have detrimental effect to the committee's bargaining position, and pursuant to Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 30A, Section 21A2, to conduct contract negotiation with non-personnel, Director of Business and Finance, Mrs. Lindsey Albernaz.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion by Mrs. Terra, seconded by Mr. Vitello. By roll call, Mrs. Rothwell?
Aye.
Mr. Vitello?
Aye.
Mr. Krupp?
Aye.
Mrs. Terra?
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. The Somerset K-8 will be returning to open session following the executive session.
To the conference room.